Welcome to the Melbourne Writers Festival. I'm Stephanie Schultz. I'm a writer and editor, and I'm excited to be hosting this event today. Firstly, I'd like to respectfully acknowledge that today we are meeting on the traditional lands of the Kulin Nation, in particular the Wurundjeri and Boon people. We pay respects to elders and to all the elders of the communities and cultures across Victoria. The Melbourne Writers Festival would also like to extend a warm thanks to the supporters of this session at Victoria University. So thanks for joining us on this session about binge culture. Just a bit of minor housekeeping. You're now locked in. You're officially in the TV lair. Can't get out there anymore. If you need to exit in an emergency or, I don't know, you don't like us, feel free to head out that way there.
Toilet emergency,
and they don't like us. So don't leave me yourself. The session will go till about 2, but 15 minutes before we are supposed to wrap up, I'm going to throw it to you guys for questions, so hold on to those until the end. So introducing my amazing panel, far left, my left, Megan Abbott is an award-winning author of 8 novels, including The End of Everything, Dare Me, and The Fever. She is also an author of The Street Was Mine, a study of hard-boiled fiction and film noir. Her work has won or been nominated for the CWA Steel Dagger, the International Thriller Writers Award, the Los Angeles Times Book Prize, and 5 Edgar Awards. Enough awards? Give me awards. Currently, she's a staff writer on HBO's new David Simon show, The Deuce, and is adapting 2 of her novels for television. Please welcome me. Brodie Lancaster is a writer, editor, and occasional DJ in Melbourne, Australia. Her writing has appeared in Rookie, Pitchfork, Rolling Stone, Jezebel, Vulture, Hello Mister, The Walking Magazine, just lots of stuff. She has spoken at Melbourne Writers Festival, Emerging Writers Festival, National Young Writers Festival, a bunch of other things, and her first book, No Way, Okay, Fine, was shortlisted for the Virtual Emerging Writers Prize in 2015. Welcome, Brodie. And to my left is Benjamin Law, an author, journalist, screenwriter, and columnist. He's the author of 2 books, The Family Law Engager, Adventures in the Queer East, both of which were nominated for ABIA Awards. He's also the creator and co-writer of award-winning SBS adaptation of The Family Law and was an associate producer and researcher on the SBS feature documentary Deep Water, The Real Story. He is author of the forthcoming quarterly essay. Is that out?
September 11th. Yeah. Very lucky day. The essay will be out.
On safe schools?
On safe schools.
Yeah, everyone get their eyes on that. And welcome, Ben. We are just going to chat TV because that's why we're here and be really quite casual about it because it's TV. Come on. Highbrow festival, but lowbrow. Speaking of lowbrow, Ben, when I was Googling for your bio, there was a quote on, I'm just trying to find it here, on The Guardian that said something about, it was talking about The Family Law, the TV adaptation, and it was talking about a turducken of mums or mothers, and I was just like, I'm just going to ask, I'm not going to read this, I'm just going to ask.
Okay, so one of my mums lives inside another. The was that we had 2 series of The Family Law now on SBS, and in each of them there is an episode where, because the show is inspired and based on my actual real family, my entire real family makes a Hitchcockian cameo appearance in the episodes. It's like an Easter egg, except you don't have to look hard to find it. They're always in the first episode. So The Guardian actually visited on day 1 of the filming of the cameo appearance, and there was my mum, real mum, Jenny, there in the middle of the audience, who is filming this entire thing on the video, even though I'm a 34-year-old adult. It's like another talent show. And also there was my TV mum, Fee Choi, who is a Melbourne-based actor. And so they were like, you know, chatting happily, and I'm probably like talking and conspiring against me as well. So I think that's where the phrase came out. It's just like, there's a mother within a mother.
I feel like that they ran with it, though. That was the headline.
How
has it been adapting? So obviously you wrote the book first, and that's a series of essays. It's non-fiction, and now you've turned it into a fictional television show.
Yeah.
Based on your real life.
Yep.
Talk us through that, if you can.
So, a collection of essays has no structure. It's like we just mushed them together and passed it off as a book, and they were like, it's a book. Buy it, believe me. has nothing but structure, you know, and because we're writing for SBS, which is a public broadcaster, but it does have ad breaks, that also enforces a much tighter three-act structure as well, with a first act, second act, third act. And because I hadn't done professional screenwriting, I studied it at university, you know, as an elective, as a postgraduate, but I hadn't had any experience in it. I come from like a background in magazine journalism. It was a real kind of, a real one-on-one to get employed on the show, essentially, and then start learning on the ground as you were writing the show. And so very early on, I learned a lot of stuff like, if it's going to be a six-parter, what were those six parts called and what is the narrative arc? So we decided that because it was a black comedy about divorce, set in Queensland, it was going to be very hot, it was going to be one of those hot Queensland summers where everything goes wrong. And we're like, well, everything is going wrong, but everything should go wrong in each of the episodes as well. So every episode was going to be set around a family celebration. And, you know, to set up those expectations to completely demolish it, because that's what we were doing with Pop Market Language generally. So the first episode is a talent show, another episode is, you know, a big day out, another episode is someone's birthday, another episode is an anniversary. And each time we just get to tear it apart. And yeah, it was that's how we did it. And because the essays take place from, you know, before I was born until present day, we can't really do that in television. So we just decided to really, really tighten the focus.
You're going
to
Benjamin Button here.
No, but I do that with the right moisturizer.
Megan, how is your experience? So obviously you're on a HBO, you're in a writing room for HBO working with the guy who created The Wire.
Cool much? It was terrifying. I had never written, you know, I had written some pilots of my own stuff, but I'd never been in a writer's room. And it was, you know, it's David Simon in The Wire. It was sort of fundamental to sort of my life. You know, it was sort of one of those first shows that, and The Sopranos in the U.S. that sort of changed TV. And this is David Simon and George Pelicanos, who also wrote for The Wire, and Richard Price, who also wrote for The Wire. And they were a famously combative, that was a famously combative writer's room, and I'd heard a lot about it. And the show is about the birth of the porn industry in 1970s New York. So it's a show about porn and like going these three tough guys. And it's like they're all like a foot tall to me, and it was all very intimidating. In the end, it's like 8 hours a day, and you're arguing with each other about everything. So there was just no way you could hang back. You know, I'm like, today I'm just gonna listen. You know, like it was just that kind of environment. You had to be ready and on and ready to fight for it. And because of the nature of the show, we're dealing with porn and prostitution and pimps, and you know, the conversation could get a little blue, as they say in America. And it was just like, it was just a crash course, and I had to sort of toughen up. And had, by the end of it, I was like, let me tell you about porn. You know? But I did watch a lot of porn for research. you had to come in with an idea. And the main thing I learned about 70s porn is that the lighting is really bad. It just, like, they hadn't figured that out yet. but it was sort of like, almost like going into a grocery store. Like, that was the lighting in a grocery store. And then showing people having sex with that kind of lighting. No one looked good. It was the 70s. People weren't grooming themselves at all, you know.
That kind of is like, I guess, TV and how the quality has progressed. Television at one point in time wasn't to be rewatched. Like,
that's
it
right.
To be aired, and that was it.
That's so right. No one would ever see it again. Yes.
Yes. Like maybe 70s porn. Videotape, not even exist yet, you know what I mean? Like, it's
right.
Not quality, whereas if now...
That's right, now it's become an art form that we know it is. Actually, not at all. it used to be more... They actually have a story in 70s porn. There's sort of a story. I'm not going to get into porn
today. I'm interested, though. Everyone talks to actors about acting out.
Yes.
Scenes. It's such a, like, you know, and they're all, it's awkward and dense. What is it... Guessing you've written sex scenes if you're writing a show.
Yes, and you have to be pretty precise. Writing them was not so hard because, because it's easier in some ways than in novels, because in novels you're really trying to recreate experience, but in the TV you have actors to do that. But going on set and watching them do it, essentially I started to feel like I was the pornographer because I had written this thing that then they had to do, and Maggie Gyllenhaal and James Franco, and they're like doing this filthy act. It's like right in front of me, and it was a weird experience. It was sort of like one's childhood fantasies of like seeing movie stars and instead of entering their world, but it was entering their world in the strangest possible way.
Brady, I'm gonna bring it up in your awesome memoir.
Bring it up.
This is my segue to The Wire. So that was on your list of shows that you haven't watched. So
yeah,
Brady, that was an amazing moment in a book you haven't read already, which is like there is no such thing as a guilty pleasure. Fuck that for a joke. Ironic watching television, whatever. This is what I love. And guess what? I haven't watched all of these really important shows.
Yeah.
The Wire was one of them.
Yeah.
Can you talk us through that idea a little bit?
Yeah, that was originally the first chapter in the book. And so it kind of like I had this really long list and I literally went on the internet and was like, golden age of television, like critically acclaimed television. And I scrolled through these lists and I was like, Breaking Bad, The Wire, The Sopranos, like I've watched the first episode of The Sopranos, but then I was like, I don't have time for it. But then, like, I just kind of, like, collected this list. I think I put movies in there as well, maybe, but maybe it was just TV. But I just collected, and what eventually became this pretty substantial list of things that I have never just, like, wanted to dedicate my time to.
Have you felt pressure to at times?
Oh, yeah, they're the ones that, I think I wrote that chapter after, like, I was at a bar and someone was talking loudly at his date about how she had to watch The Wire.
Oh,
you have to watch it. This is what it is and this is why you have to watch it.
Mansplaining The Wire.
Like,
got his phone number.
In like a bar, like, okay. And so I was like, thankfully not in that conversation, but I was like, my God, the amount of times I have been talked at about why Breaking Bad should matter to me, and I'm like, it fucking doesn't, like, and it never will. And so I kind of wrote it, and I was like, this is tricky territory, because it's like, you know, I write some criticism in my, like, freelance writing, and there is this kind of, like, critical hierarchy of things that are good, things we all agree are good, things we all agree are terrible, and things in the middle that are just kind of, like, niche or, like,
or like Taylor Swift's song that no one will ever agree on.
Yeah, there's that big mass grey area in the middle where Taylor lives. But, like, all of the things that I love the most, you know, like, I'm obsessed with Game of Thrones at the moment. That's, like, obviously at the top of the hierarchy. But all of the things that I spend the bulk of my time on are the ones at the bottom. And I just kind of, like, became obsessed with this idea that, you know, all of the things that I genuinely really loved spending my time consuming were the ones that I was supposed to feel shame about. Meanwhile, no one's ever going to hate watch The Wire. No one's ever going to, like, be like, oh, my guilty pleasure is Led Zeppelin. Like, they're just, there's this rule that, like, and it's just, you know, like, it's the common theme between all the things that are good and, like, critically acclaimed and right are the things that are made by, for, or about men, and all the things at the bottom are the things made by, for, or about women. Or queer people, or young people, or young women especially, you know, there's just this kind of, like, hierarchy of taste, and all the things that I really like live at the bottom of it, and I don't think that that's right.
Yeah. I was listening to an episode of the podcast, Another Round, the other day, and they had someone on there who had to share it. I think that's what I was listening to. Had to share opinion that was going to piss the audience off, and one of them was, I just don't like Game of Thrones, I don't watch Game of Thrones. And the reason they gave, I'm fine, like, you can not like it. I like it.
Yeah.
Like the dragons, like the nudity, whatever. Was that it's a soap opera. And I'm like, that is why it is great TV.
Yeah.
Great TV. Like, soap operas are sort of staple of television.
Mm.
We were just having a conversation about reality TV then. Do you want to give some examples of what you guys watch and are into?
Well, we were having a very involved discussion about the Real Housewives franchise before, which I actually feel is akin to Shakespeare.
I agree completely.
It's so heightened. Like, when you actually do watch a good Shakespearean production, of which there are a few, but when you actually watch one, it's so over the top.
Yeah.
You know, it's just like, who are you to say that, and what are you? Like,
yeah.
It's ridiculous. It's so. And then Real Housewives, it's just like, it brings it
taken to another level. And you combine that with, like, neo-capitalism, which is just hideous, and you combine it with women who are so strong and fierce, it passes
so
the Bechdel test, by the way.
So much food.
You know,
oh, yeah.
The women in these stories very rarely talk about men.
They have no interest in their spouses at all.
Which I love. And if anything, the spouses are, like, a point of deep condescension, which is just like, oh, my hideous husband over there, who is so clearly hideous, the camera cuts to you've married a dog.
There are also these incredible moments where they try to one-up one another or fight with one another about them living off their husband's money.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
that's the point of, like, deep shame.
Well, especially
women
in
as
the
well.
Australasian ones as well, like the ocean. Sorry, this is getting a bit dense now.
Prefer the Antipodean.
Yeah. Oceania installments as well. But it's a huge point, like, why
yeah.
don't you get a job, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And that brings this whole interesting
like real estate
conversation
models.
Up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not that well. It is like it's if Lady Macbeth and Cleopatra were the only like and they were like it was a whole room of Lady Macbeth and Cleopatra going at each other.
Yeah.
And in America, it's really the only shows that talk about class openly.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
so like let the you know, The Wire, and I love The Wire, but I mean people sort of praise that for its discussion of class. But class is all over The Real Housewives and how we measure things in the U.S. and what, you know, and what it means, you know, what how you demonstrate your prestige and how people can fall.
And the dynamics between these incredibly, incredibly rich people and the help, for instance.
Oh,
you know, like, that is really, really shocking. And,
oh my
like,
God,
in the
Lydia.
Melbourne franchise, yeah, Lydia and, yes.
Her housekeeper, who she says, I love her, she's just gorgeous. Cut to Lydia, like, yelling at this woman, telling her how to drive.
Yeah. and then she goes, it's ching ching, not chung chung.
Oh
and
my
she's,
God.
Like, giving her driving instructions. And you just see this fascinating, naked, horrific racism that she thinks is completely appropriate.
Yeah.
And they just show it. They just show it.
And maybe they point it. I mean, the editing is so brilliant on the show because they want you to see that. They're pointing at things.
Yeah.
And that's like, because they could obviously don't need to use that, but they want to use it because they want to show that, which I think is what makes it so great.
What's really interesting is one of my friends is the executive producer of the show. And they had this session recently that I couldn't attend, but it was a conversation between two of the Australian housewives, so there's Melbourne and now there's Sydney, and it was between Melissa Towers and Janet Roach.
Oh,
and,
good mix.
And the housewives were saying that there has been no housewife who's ever said they've been edited badly. The producers are really proud that the women feel they've been represented properly.
Mm.
But when you watch a show, it's like, you are obviously a monster.
Jennifer, in the very first episode, was at the hairdresser saying she never washes her own hair. She goes to the hairdresser every time she has to get her hair done and then tries to steal a designer dog and run out of the hairdresser.
But I think that's so fascinating.
Yeah.
That deep lack of self-awareness of how you might be perceived by other people is just, like, it's anthropology. I kind of feel like I'm watching a strange, bizarre Attenborough documentary on late capitalism.
It's like all these personality disorders assembled and wonder. I have a friend who's a psychologist, and she can't watch it because it's like, I do this all day, honey. I'm not watching it. Narcissist, you know, like bipolar, like, yeah. Like,
I just recently watched the, like, Jersey Shore reunion, which was, so I thought it was going to be a reunion series. It was only like a 20-minute TV episode, but it was like Snooki, JWoww, The Situation, like Paulie D, like all our faves from the Jersey Shore, right, everybody? They all got back together in New Jersey. They couldn't go to the place where they set the show because the town of Seaside, New Jersey, did not want them back, even all these years later. So they just went to a neighboring town, and they went to this bar where Jenny was like, I peed on the floor here. Anyway, but they had this conversation where they talked about how the fights that broke out between, like, two key characters who had been in a relationship happened because before the cameras started rolling, the producers took them out outside and were like, okay, these are the episodes that are airing right now from last season. We need this season to, like, react to last season, but you guys haven't watched the show yet. So they sat a character down and showed her the episode that shows her boyfriend cheating on her and then sent her back into the house to, like, film what ended up being season two. It's not really related to anything except that kind of manipulation that, like, is not happening with
the real housewives. Because it's like the artifice that's behind reality TV. Yeah. It's written, it's staged, I think.
Yeah. The other thing about the whole discussion about reality TV is, you know, in every genre, there's good and bad. Like, prestige drama has some objectively bad shows.
Tedious.
Kind of announce how important they are, and you're like, that sucks.
Yeah.
And reality TV, similarly, has really, really great examples of the genre and really, really terrible examples of the genre as well. Like, some reality TV shows are what people think of the genre. Like, they are plainly nasty and they're mean and they punch down rather than have a really interesting
The people are so dumb. I mean, that's what, you know, one of the things I like about The Housewives is there's always a few really smart ones.
Really
and
smart.
They, you know, and they, you know, but like Bachelor in Paradise, is there's like, you're not going to get that there, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you know, I mean, to me, that's sort of the low, you know, and I don't believe in guilty pleasures either. And I know people that love all of the Bachelor ones, but the Bachelor in Paradise, even among the Bachelor ones, I think is a, you know, they're trying to milk something there.
Totally.
Yeah.
So when people dismiss like a genre outright, like reality television or, you know, low programming or whatever, I kind of feel that skepticism towards them. As I would those people who say they don't watch television generally.
Yeah,
right.
I love it. I don't own a TV. It used to be.
I
think
it's like, but is it
yeah, completely. That's true.
Yeah.
Do you guys, how do you watch TV? Because for me, it was like, I'm like that chihuahua meme that's going around with the guy popping out of bed. It's like, that's all I watch. And then eventually I'll resurface. So I'm in bed with my computer. What do you, guys binge? Or?
I'm a big like before, I was on the tram coming here and I was trying to remember all of the things that I have binged just the last few months because there's been a lot. Like, I watched all of Vanderpump Rules, which is 5 seasons, increasingly longer seasons with like 3-part reunion episodes at the end. It's a reality show in like 10 days. I have a full time job. Like, it's not right. But it's all on my computer because I have like Netflix and Hayu, which I pay for, and then I didn't want to pay for a third one, so I gave a friend my Hayu login. He gave me his Stan login, so then I had Stan because I had to watch RuPaul's Drag Race. I watched all of that this year as well. I watched all of Playing House a couple weeks ago just because I finished the new season and wanted more, so I went back and watched it all from the start. All computer.
Mm.
Like, sometimes I'll watch the TV. I was watching The American Bachelor last season on my TV just because I happened to be home on Tuesday nights. But I barely watch anything on my computer anymore.
I'm not a big binger. In fact, it's not out of any lack of commitment to these shows. I love TV, but I do. I was just saying that on the plane, I flew from New York, so the closest I got was like, because I was on the plane. I'm gonna binge watch Veep, and I'm gonna. But normally, I can only do two hours in a row of one show, and then in part it's because I like to space it out because I don't watch as many, and I love the ones I watch so deeply. But I think, you know, it's like I'm a bit older than both of you, and so like part of it is sort of the old TV habits are still sort of in me. Like, I prefer to watch on my TV, and I finally figured out I have no technological skills at all. Like, oh, I can have, if it comes on my TV, if it comes on my computer, I can get it on my TV. I'm just sort of figuring that out. But once I'm committed to something, I will watch it. I'm a completist. Like, I want to see all of it. And that's why if I get too far behind Game of Thrones, I should have started at the beginning, and now I feel like I can't catch up. Same with The Americans. But I'm deeply committed to it. So, like, Real Housewives, I have not missed any episode of New York or Beverly Hills. Those are my heart. That's where my heart is, and I will see them all. And I will even watch the reunions, every part of the reunion, and then I will watch the recap, and then I will show the lot. I will watch the lost footage show. So I would say less a binger than a completist.
Yeah. Totally.
As for me, like, when I was going through university, I had like the smallest, shittiest television. It was kind of like this big. My laptop was literally bigger than the screen that I had for my TV. And then my boyfriend's mom intervened, and she's just like, "You need to stop being garbage." And she got us, like a decent television, and that was like a long time ago. To the point where, you know, like when TVs got like really big all of a sudden,
yes.
I was just like, "Whoa!"
What the fuck? It's like the Olympics are on. Everyone has a big screen.
Yes. Yeah.
But we didn't cave into that. But now we live in an apartment block where we've kind of got like an intra apartment gum tree, and people are always moving in and out. It's like, I need to chuck out a TV or So we've upgraded like twice, and I've been able to give like the slightly smaller TV to a friend for their PlayStation habit or whatever. So I feel like, you know, nice little
commune going
on. So now we've got an okay sized TV. And because for the first time in my life recently I can afford Foxtel, I'm like, yes, I won't pirate anymore in my life at all. So we've got
tax deductible.
Yeah, totally. Right. Yeah, tax deductible. So we've got proper.
I'll
show you my Excel spreadsheet.
Yes.
And so.
It changed my life.
But the thing about Foxtel now, I mean, for those of you who actually paid legally for the first time because Foxtel actually had the app and then it all crashed, you know, Foxtel's technology is still a little bit, so we've still got that massive box that's like the size of, you know, a human toddler living underneath our television. I can kind of do amazing things. Like, I can record a show from my phone app, which I think is
amazing, like the IQ
box. But then the layout looks like Microsoft 95, you know, like it's really, really strange. Yeah, so I've still got all these, like, devices coming out of my television that I just want to, you know, I'm a minimalist. I just want to get rid of that very soon. I look forward to the day. But, yeah, mainly it's long day at work, slumped, exhausted, to the point where you're so exhausted that the Handmaid's Tale is considered relaxing.
Well, we touched on the Handmaid's Tale before we came out here, and I think that the idea of binging is different for different shows, for sure. Like, so sitting down and watching a sitcom, Veep, sitting down and watching reality TV is one thing. Sitting down and binging The Handmaid's Tale is a whole, like, you've got to not want to see
people. I have something about this.
Yes.
Sorry to raise my hand on the panel. But, like, I was just thinking about this because I, like, I have something to say about all of these things, but, like, The Handmaid's Tale I found so, like, after, I think it was, like, the first three episodes came out all at once, and I watched them all and just felt like I had, an anvil in my guts. Like, I could barely move. But the soundtrack was so kind of, like, ooh, like, it didn't fit anything. So for anyone who hasn't watched it, the first, like, three episodes end with, like, really up, like, it's this depressing, grim show, but they end with, like, Don't You Forget About Me by Simple Minds? Yeah. And then, and then the next episode ends with, like, oh, God, what was it? Like, some other, like, kind of, like, really upbeat, kind of, like, 80s kind of, like, pop or rock song. And I was like, this is so fucking weird. And then I, like, and it just didn't fit tonally to me. And then I, like, looked it up, and there were all these not theories, but people talking about it online, that was purposely done for the binging experience, because if someone just watched this dire, like, depressing show that went into another dire episode, it's like, yeah, it's like...
It'd be like watching Requiem for the Dream.
It's like your DVD player breaks and it just keeps skipping over back onto itself. But yeah, it's like, as if they fit tonally, like the idea of, like, not forgetting about these fucking forgettable women. Yeah, and I found it so interesting that this show seems to have been designed, because it's on Hulu as well, but, like, seems to have been designed purely to be binged. And that this musical decision to, like, put these kind of, like, bursts of energy so that you don't just, like, close the laptop and think it's done.
Twin Peaks is doing the same thing now. They're ending with a... I love it so much, but it's very hard to watch. It's complex.
Yes.
And often quite grim and violent, but it ends with a musical number, and that's a, I had not thought about that possibility, because I don't think Lynch thinks that way, but I heard this great theory online that it was a nod to those shows like 90210, like with Peach Pit After Dark, where they would end the episode with a band, and I kind of like that notion too, so... It is, there's something kind of postmodern about the whole conception, you know, because these are 80s songs, or these are riffing on shows from the 90s, but in this new way that we consume it.
Totally.
So there's this mix of nostalgia and, I don't know.
Well, it's like how you were saying, like, that, like, writing the show for ad breaks, kind of like the structure that is so specific. That's one of the things that I like in the inverse, where there are no ad breaks on Netflix, is one of the reasons why I think Netflix dramas sometimes get let down by the pacing.
Yeah.
Like, the Gilmore Girls reboot of, like, 90-minute episodes that should have been 40-minute episodes. They would have been so strong as 40-minute episodes, but it's like, we have the freedom. We can go as long as we want and no ad breaks and, like, it's all fine. It weighs it down. And so that, like, that old structure of Gilmore Girls being paced, I think they did four acts in the original series, but, like, forcing those breaks in made it such a perfectly paced show.
But even watching, like, this is a very different show. I've been watching Annabelle Crabb's The House on ABC, and this is essentially a four-part documentary series about the history of Australian Parliament House. This sounds like a pretty tough offer for a lot of people, right?
Annabelle Crabb.
Except it's Annabelle Crabb, and also, like, she's so brilliant and singularly great at showing the batshittery of hallowed institutions such as Australian government, you know? And what I found really interesting is the narrative structure that they've used. I mean, it borrows, like, a lot of narrative conventions from, like, really good half-hour dramas, but also, like, they're quite aware that it's going to be an iView product as well that you can catch up on later. And so they've draped all of this really fascinating information about Parliament House. But you know that if you don't have a story, it's going to just feel like a Wikipedia entry as well. So they've taken the first new sitting of Australian Parliament, and you've got all those newcomers that are not newcomers to us anymore in 2017, but it's like fascinating to watch these MPs go into Parliament for the first time and what the hell are they going to encounter as well. And Ali, you know, like first Muslim Australian MP, what's she going to encounter, how she's going to be frustrated, and there's this really great kind of narrative tension that's baked into a documentary format that you don't expect and makes it really, really watchable.
I really want to watch that now.
Yeah, I know. Find out more.
And I guess, well, Current Affairs is really interesting. That just made me think about, because the news is on TV. You remember how that's how we would...
That's the only thing I watch on broadcast TV.
It is?
Everything else is catch-up.
Yeah. That's interesting, because I know a lot of other people just use, like, their phones and apps and notifications and that kind of thing to catch up on the news. Do you guys watch things live on the TV and do the Twitter thing?
I was thinking the other day, the only thing I watch live is Game of Thrones now. Well, not, and it's not live because it, like, you know, I have to stop looking at Twitter at 11 o'clock on a Monday because I'm at work and I'm on Twitter all day. And I have to stop because everyone's live tweeting it in America. No one cares about spoilers anymore. Yep. So I just have to, like, not look at it because I don't want to mute the Game of Thrones hashtag because I still want to look later. But, stop looking at it and then go to a friend's house every Monday night and we watch it together. And then straight away I, like, go home, go on Twitter, go to the Ringer Twitter account. They do a live Periscope chat show about, like, my Game of Thrones consumption cycle is, like, fucking crazy. And then I'm like, Tuesday morning, Sinead's recap goes up on Junkie. And then, like, Thursday, the Binge Mode podcast comes out where I listen to an hour and a half of it. And then, like, today when I go home, there'll be a video explainer episode up. But it's, like, everything else is not live. Like, that's the only thing I watch.
I've got, like, a half-week schedule of, like, rituals that I do after the episode comes out. Like, the New York Times is a really great mail out where they not only have, like, three in-house writers writing about Game of Thrones, but then they'll have, like, and here's what you missed elsewhere as well, and they've always got, like, really great links. Like, there was a great New Yorker link about the embroidery on Game of Thrones and, like, all these historical references that I've built in. It's amazing.
I had watched all my recaps last weekend and I was like, what am I going to do now? And so I just went online and typed in, like, Game of Thrones costumes, and I found, like, four behind-the-scenes videos, and I was like, this is my night. Like, I don't think there's any other show that, like, I just want expertise on it. Like, I want to know everything about it. But,
all of the theories as well, because
it's a particularly fetching season. And because the books aren't a thing anymore, like, it's even the playing field between, like, people who know the books and people who just watch the show. It's really nice.
What are you going to do with all that time?
Well, after it's done, you mean? Yeah. Like, after the month?
Last year I watched all of it again. Like,
wow.
But I submitted the manuscript for my book a year ago on Monday or Tuesday. And so, like, kind of this time last year, maybe, like, July last year, I was like, I'm just going to go back to the start. Like, I'm on this deadline. I don't want to write my book. I'm, like, so, like,
that's
scared
amazing.
Of it. So I just went, like, but it's because I'd seen it all before. I just kind of had it playing while I, like, cooked dinner and did other things. But, I ended up, like, I just focused on, ended up writing something about it to, like, justify the time. But I also, like, I like honed in on Sansa like from the first episode to where she is now, and so I was like keeping heaps of like obsessive notes about everything that happened to her, and then wrote this like opus about Sansa.
There's a bunch of other characters you can go back and do that.
Yeah, maybe I'll do that.
So after
the finale. After
she learns Doctor Who.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Where do we think it's going to go next? So we were talking as well about how Game of Thrones is this big moment, and do you feel like you have missed?
No, I had a dragon cast, but I don't think I was ever going to get past it. But I do miss, it's weird, it's, some of it, I enjoy actually the response to it, in a way that's sort of delightful. I do like to hear theories, and I get it, because like Twin Peaks, sort of, I do watch that live, and I do love to read everything about the next day, especially with that, there is no clarity. No one seems to have any clarity on anything that's going on. So I love reading the theories. But I kind of enjoy the sort of more peripheral intensity of the Games of Thrones people. And it's funny how the thing you're not watching, that's ridiculous what you're doing. Whereas I did the same thing with Mad Men. So I would like the costumes on Mad Men. You know, I would go down all those wormholes. I just think it's, you know... But the question as to where do we go from here, I think, is really significant, because we have sort of, in the U.S., there's this, you know, there's a sense that this is peak TV and that like, there's just too much now, and there's so much we're missing all the time. And a place like Netflix can't really promote the show, so they're dumping a lot of shows and no one's finding them. And like, where do we go?
Post-peak TV. Yeah. Right? It got so big that now it's like... scrambling.
That's right. No, and it really, with The Deuce, which is start soon, it's sort of, HBO is sort of, people were making fun of them for so long for only having one night of original TV, but in some ways it feels like a good thing, because actually they're going to get attention for that night, and they're going to get all this coverage, just like, you know, because, you know, there's actually the awareness that people will all be watching it at once, and I think it's much harder for some of these shows on Hulu and Amazon in particular. They've dumped a lot of stuff. They don't really have an infrastructure for it either. They don't have like the huge talent departments. You know, they're not really made for this. These are businesses. So it will be a big question to see and there will be survivors, but who they will be.
Yeah.
I mean, do you feel like you have missed stuff that, you know, was gone forever or...
Yeah, there are several waves that I feel I missed, but I just want to pick up on one of your other points as well, because I find as time goes on, you like, for instance, Disney is withdrawing
its
products from Netflix as well. So the market is fragmenting even further, and there are only so many subscriptions that people are willing to take up as well. So that has a really big question mark over, well, where do people go? And will you ever be able to build the strongest audience that you used to? You know, like, so this is very, very different. But did anyone listen to that Making Oprah podcast?
I did.
This is like a podcast series.
Oh my god!
Like, it's an oral history.
I cried listening to a Black Eyed Peas song on a podcast.
That's
how good it is. It's so
amazing.
I listened to it on a plane. It was so moving.
Yeah. It was really great.
But you think about, like, one of the things that I took away from it is Oprah was very much of a time and space because that was when, you know, so much of the broadcast ratings were consolidated and funneled into certain things. And now we're at the other end where it's so fragmented. There'll never be another Oprah Winfrey again. And I just wonder with these great shows that we really do hold in high esteem, like what happens to them beyond this? Yeah. Or does it kind of contract to what you're talking about? We can finally like get a bit of focus and then it's like, oh yeah, The Juice is on, let's just focus on one thing at a time.
It's that kind of thing where it's like, are the networks going to appreciate the nicheness of their programming without like these big shows like Game of Thrones that everyone watched, these monoculture shows? Because like I remember reading some stat years ago that was like, if MASH premiered today with the numbers that it premiered to when it first came out, it would never have got a whole season.
Mm-hmm.
Like this insanely like classic long-running show, the standards now for how many people need to watch certain shows are so much higher that they're not given a chance to germinate and reach their like niche audiences who are going to really love them and get behind them, that then, because there's this pressure for them to obviously, like advertisers and studios and whatever, networks need to get more eyeballs.
Yeah.
But
There's another important conversation that needs to happen in Australia as well, because we're a much smaller country. We've got like 24 million people. That's like, what, a small Scandinavian country or something like that in this big landmass. And I was at the Australian Writers Guild Awards last night, the Audi Awards, and there's a really big conversation at the moment because the federal government, Conservative government, wants to get rid of quotas as well. And at
can
its
you
time,
explain to people?
So you know, for a very long time, broadcast networks have had to produce X amount of Australian content and X amount of Australian kids' TV content as well. And broadcasters are saying that now that we've got competitors like Netflix and Amazon coming in with their glut of overseas products, we shouldn't have to be obliged to keep producing Australian content, whereas the Australian Writers Guild stance is that, well, if Netflix and Amazon want to be in this market, they should be obliged to be in this, they should only be in this market if they have the obligation to make Australian content. And we are seeing Australian content that is being watched. So Stan, for instance, has just launched The Other Guy with Matt O'Kine as well, which I've only just started watching and is really, really, really terrific as well. You're starting to see co-productions between ABC and Netflix as well. So those models are already there and they can be successful. They're experiments at the moment, but for instance, Glitch on ABC, the second series, which is coming out soon. Netflix is also doing co-pro with the ABC for Alison Bell's great piloted comedy about being a new parent, The Letdown.
Yeah, yeah.
And so that's going to be an international exported product as well. And I think that other people can be interested in Australian stories, and we shouldn't necessarily see ourselves as just being completely
transparent.
Please like me going overseas to the US and UK as well. So that's another conversation we've got to have in this country.
You keep having your actors come
and
especially the men. It's so funny, you know, but it's weird that you know, I mean, I don't think there's any, like, other than The Real Housewives, clearly The Vanguard, any Australian shows that they've shown.
Yeah.
In the US.
Well, you know, Real Housewives in Melbourne runs in primetime in Bravo now, so that's one example of our message.
Well, it definitely enticed me to come here.
We've already said it, but we need to mention that Real Housewives of Sydney not aired in America because what was that?
It was too nasty.
It was such a mess.
Also, when you're casting like Lisa Oldfield, who is, you know, the partner of deep, notorious racist David.
Also,
Oldfield.
Snake owner and doomsday prepper Lisa Oldfield.
Oh my god!
It's actually pretty watchable.
Yeah.
Good.
Well, it sounds wonderful to me.
Oh my god.
Before I phone the audience for questions, I thought, given the fact that there is so much television and we're talking about it, what would be one thing that you would recommend? I'll give you a second because I'm going
to
start.
Oh, to watch?
One thing that you would recommend to watch. Mine is Terrace House on Netflix.
It's Japanese reality TV show.
Terrace House forced me to not play Candy Crush on my phone while I watch TV, which is my usual mode.
Because of the subtitles?
Because of the subtitles.
Yeah, me too. Normally, I play Solitaire. Because I'm a child of the 90s. And it's really great. It's really hard to explain because it's kind of like one of those nothing really happens, they live their life, but it's kind of the antithesis of that bitchy
life. I just
like
Big Brother meets Jersey Shore, but in Japan, so everyone's nice.
Everyone's so nice.
On Jersey Shore, they could leave their house and have jobs and go out like they do on Terrace House. But everyone's kind and cooks dinners for each other. That would be delicious.
So where does drama come from?
The drama comes from, well, for example, one episode, a beautiful hairdresser, one of his clients gave him some very expensive meat that was in the fridge, and everyone else came home and was like, we're hungry, and his girlfriend was like, let's cook this meat and eat it.
Meat. Uh-oh.
And in another episode, before they got together, they like had, he had not done something, and so she made him like rice with like egg on it and written coward in tomato sauce.
The Japanese culture, like that is.
Yeah,
like,
they have this incredible thing where they'll play a scene and then they'll pop back to people like us in a room watching it with headphones in, and then it cuts and then they all go, oh. They have a nickname, like the guy who tap dances, they just call him Tap.
It's really good. And that kind of, I think, is the next level in reality TV of having that title in there.
Bachelor Australia is doing it right now.
And it really kind of
makes the viewer feel empowered, because I'm like, that's exactly what I thought. That's exactly.
Is it kind of like the updated laugh track or something?
Yeah, almost.
Like Big Brother Up Late or something, where they talk about the show while you watch the show.
I remember when that was the height of like the scary reality.
Big Brother Up Late.
So what would you recommend?
I have two really quick. The one would be The Keepers, which is a documentary on Netflix. It's a true crime documentary about this nun in Baltimore in the U.S. who was murdered in the late 1960s. And it sounds very grim, and in some ways it is, but it becomes this much larger story, and it has these very heroic women at the center of it, and it's completely engrossing, and you can't stop watching it. I did binge watch that. But the other verse is The Great British Baking Show, which, if you haven't watched it, in these troubled times,
is amazing. Are you watching the original?
We don't. That's the only one we have as of now in the U.S., and there's three seasons of it, and I don't care about baking or any of these things. It's so beautiful. Everyone's so nice. It's so multicultural. There's something so pleasing about it. It's like
really funny. Like we,
it's like a baked good.
We're just like, we love our dramatic reality TV shows, but we love these nice ones too.
That's why MasterChef has kind of endured as well, as much as it's competitive as well.
Yeah.
You know, people really love that. Yes, you're going to be eliminated, but we still love you.
Yes.
And that's why MasterChef Australia, in particular, which is similarly, I think, one of the most multicultural shows on Australian television, is huge in India. Like, when you go to India, because I'm not very literate in cricket, and that's the only other thing you can talk about as an Australian, but I do know that I can talk about MasterChef in India, and that's going to be a really interesting conversation. Yeah. Like, they have op-eds in their business pages about MasterChef Australia and what managers can learn from
That's also an interesting, like, to link, obviously, TV back to writing. The writing around it, obviously, criticism, I write criticism. We read it. There's so much amazing kind of content out there that's like.
Which will win Pulitzers as well, and should.
Exactly. Yeah. Brady, what's your recommend?
I mentioned it a second ago, but Playing House, I just love. It's like a US comedy created by Jessica St. Clair and Lennon Parham. Lennon P. But they made this show called Best Friends Forever for NBC years ago, and it got like 6 episodes, and it's, I think I mentioned it in that same chapter in my book of like something that I will dedicate the time to going back and re-watching these 6 pure, beautiful episodes of a show about these two friends. One, they live on opposite sides of the country, one's in Brooklyn, one's in like Seattle or San Francisco or something. Her husband sends her divorce papers. In the opening scene, they're on Skype when she gets them, and then she moves in with her friend and her friend's partner, and it's just them kind of like cohabitating. But then, so that show got cancelled by NBC, and they have this new show called Playing House, which is a similar kind of concept. It's like one of them is like high-flying business lady in Hong Kong, and the other one is pregnant at home with her husband. And her friend comes back for her baby shower, during which they discover that her husband has been carrying on this affair with a woman over the internet. And so that's the setup, is that she gets rid of her husband, her friend moves in to help her raise this baby with her. It's so good. And like recently I realized that the 3rd season was out, because obviously it doesn't come on Australian TV, so I like really downloaded it, watched it all in like a weekend, and then was like, I love this show too much, I can't stop. And so I went back to season 1, watched all 3 seasons again in like a day, and cried, and I, like, it's just so good.
All the emotion. Yeah. And you've talked about, like, going back and rewatching things, like Best Friends and
Oh, yeah.
And I go back and rewatch things. I have my annual VOC viewing. That's just, like, my rich friends.
Yeah.
They're not real.
I'm a season 4 purist of VOC as
that's
well.
Interesting. Like,
yeah.
That's interesting. We'll talk later.
Yeah.
We'll talk later. Do you, Ben, go back and rewatch old favourites?
No, but I'm really, really actually keen to watch Game of Thrones from the start. I mean, in terms
of... I'm really, really
keen. Going back to season 1 being like, oh, the battle from here when the Trident and this. And
but it's quite remarkable that show has structured itself to know, even from Series 2, and I guess they had a map as well, what would be happening in Series 7. Like, there are all these callbacks that are so impressive because they're not just doing like, and then, and then, and then, and then. Like, everything has a meaning right from the start. And look, in terms of the stuff I'm watching, probably the big two that everyone else is watching at the moment, Game of Thrones and The Handmaid's Tale. And I know this sounds like really stupid and ridiculous, but for me as a Game of Thrones fan, it's one of those shows that makes you feel lucky to be alive right now. Like, you know, there are
probably
one
missing.
But you know, like, all of us have those shows or those phenomenons where it's like,
yeah.
You know, if you come into Game of Thrones new now, you know that there are dragons involved. But when you watched it, like, just from series one, that was kind of like, you know, a thing that developed from there. Now
yeah.
Everyone knows that there are dragons, blah, 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 blah. But to not know what's happening, to feel that liveness, like, that
yeah.
won't, that, you can't replicate that again.
Totally.
It was kind of like the kids who grew up with Harry Potter as well, as the books
yeah.
were coming out. Like,
yeah.
my youngest sister
mm.
was the same age as Harry and his friends as each of the books came out.
Yeah, me too.
Like, yeah, and that, like, that's the kind of, like, that can't be replicated. Kids will discover Harry Potter again, and, but to have that whole world in that moment
yeah.
together is really quite magical. But in terms of other recommendations, I'm just catching up with the latest series of Catastrophe, Rob Delaney and Sharon Morgan, and I just think for such a simple premise, which is a comedy about marriage and kids, it's got the sharpest dialogue, some of the most heartbreaking set pieces, some of the most funny things, like when Rob breaks down in the last episode I watched and he's just not coping and he's just like, and this happens, and I've had like diarrhea for like weeks, you know.
I love it.
I guess the other thing is Australian stuff. Annabelle Crabb's The House has been like really impressive to me. I'm just like, I love educational stuff that also entertains
yeah.
me. And because Australian politics is so fucked up at the moment, it's a really great literacy for all of us to have, because I don't think we're taught civics very well in this
yeah.
country. And then the other thing I'm looking forward to is Get Kraken.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
What's that?
The Catering Show Girls.
Oh, yeah.
Are doing a piss take of breakfast television. So, I'm going to show you Catering Show. And it's like a full half-hour piss take of breakfast TV that I've just been waiting for, because it is the worst genre
yeah.
in Australian
yeah.
television.
It's like the leave laughing gas on or something.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And it's just full of infomercials and racist
yeah.
stuff. That's all Australian breakfast
TV. I saw some of it this morning and I thought it was a joke show. Like, I thought it was
yes.
a joke. And then I realized it in a moment, but I never knew, like, some sense that the world, and I wait a minute, is this the news?
Now we
saw
it.
I thought, this is jet lag, this can't be real, but it is,
but
okay.
Like, welcome to a company
yeah.
all the programming is white, just in the
yeah.
morning, yes, and at other times as well.
Just in the daylight hours, and often at night.
Yes.
In Australian TV, I think I'd also recommend this season of Australian Survivor. I know that's, but they're
yeah.
throwing everything at it, everything.
In a good
like,
way.
Yeah, yeah, in a good way. If we can lift the lights, if possible, we might throw it open for questions. Does anyone have any cues for the aid? Yeah? Do we have a mic? Yeah. Sorry, just one moment.
So mine's about with the guilty pleasures you mentioned before. I think with my guilty pleasures, they're things that are problematic. So, I was wondering about your thoughts on loving problematic TV.
I feel that way. Like, I just recently did all, as I said, all of Vanderpump Rules, which is like an objectively horrible show. Well, it's not a horrible show, it's filled with horrible people, except like one. Like, Ariana's okay. Yeah, I sometimes have to just kind of like self rationalize in a way that I know doesn't really hold up to criticism. Like, I'll be like, well, it's okay, because like like we were just talking about Silicon Valley before, where I like recommended it to a friend after watching the first couple of seasons and thinking it was so funny, and she was like, I don't know if I want to watch a show about tech bros where there are no women, or the ones who are like bossy kind of like nags. And I was like, true. Like, I can't rationalize it, but I'm also like, well, all the dudes in it, they're not heroes, they're not anti-heroes, they're just, like, horrible men who are, like, making a mess of the world and their lives and relationships. So it's not like they're coming out great in this show that's all guys, but I also kind of, I sometimes in my, like, rationalizing of problematic, like, genuinely problematic shows, it kind of falls flat, yeah. Because I enjoy watching them, and I'm like, I know that they're not good, like, yeah.
But there's sometimes, like now, I was thinking this with the Joss Whedon revelations last week, but one of the shows I love is Louis C.K. And there's some things that have come out about him that, and weirdly, I knew them a long time ago. And I have a friend who's a comedian in the comedy circuit. So there's some stories of them that you'll all find out about next week. But some of you may know already about his sort of behavior towards certain female comedians. And his show is so brave, and he has so many great women on the show, female characters, and the daughters are great, and Pamela Adlon is great. But it, like, we're always watching it. I'm knowing that in his personal life, he's and professional, because he made some people's professional careers somewhat difficult. There's this. So am I endorsing it in some way by watching his show, which I think is actually quite wonderful.
Yeah. So, I only read that this morning, actually. And I mean, for any of you who are fans of Louis, and I am a big fan of the show, because I just think it's got such great insights into relationships.
And his stand-up.
And then you read something like that, and it's like, I feel defiled.
What did you read? Can you just...
I almost, like, can't talk about it, but then I'll have to act it out. I don't want to do that either.
Kind of in the context of Tig Notaro, the new season of Tig Notaro show One Mississippi, which is really great and you should watch if you feel like illegally downloading it, because there's no way to watch it otherwise. But the new season is coming out, and there's a storyline in it where her real life wife has this kind of like power imbalance, sexually uncomfortable situation with this man. I don't know if it's a comedian in the show, I haven't watched it, it's not out yet, but it's Louis is an executive producer of that show, and so his name comes up at this opening credits, like executive producer Louis C.K., and so Tig Notaro is having to talk about it, about his involvement in the show, and she's said, like, he is not involved in the show, he's not in the writer's room, he doesn't give feedback, his name is on it, I don't, like, she's said that he needs to confront these, like, accusations, and has made it pretty clear that she's not on board with him as a person, but he gets a lot of credit for her kind of resurgence in her career, so it's this really kind of like weird merch.
You guys can Google Louis C.K. accusations, and then you'll realize why we just don't want to.
Yeah, I'm suddenly cross-legged.
Well, it's just like, you know, this early in the day as well.
It's one of those situations where it's not like something that you, it's not just some private perversion, which I like, go ahead. But it became a professional issue, which often happens in these cases. It's sort of like the Joss Whedon case of last week, you know, it's when you see that it actually had an impact on the way, on women's careers, and that's when it gets problematic. Yeah. Sorry for being indiscreet, but the actual story is kind of inappropriate to talk about here.
So probably. So the answer is...
I think it's fine to be uncomfortable and to reassess. I mean,
so
like,
too.
For instance, you know, I was a really big fan of Chris Lilly's work, and I even wrote about We Can Be Heroes in like a thesis several years ago, because I thought like the Ricky Wong character, for any of you, those of you who've seen We Can Be Heroes, I was just like, wow, so he's like a white guy doing yellow face, and his yellow face character is doing black face, and I thought it was this genius meta commentary on how inappropriate blackface and yellowface were, and I'm like, so I was kind of defending him in my thesis, but then as the shows kind of went on, and especially by the time we got to S-Mouse, and I just didn't know why he was doing blackface, like what was he satirizing except to say black rappers are idiots, and I just thought, wow, that's really, really gross, and so I've kind of had to look at him in a different lens as well, and I think that's a healthy thing.
It gets people talking, right? At the very least. We've probably got time for one more quick question, if there is one, and then it'll be...
there's so many.
Yes.
I was just listening to an episode of Still Processing, which is currently my favorite podcast. It's by it's a New York Times podcast hosted by Jenna Wortham and Wesley Morris, who are two writers for the New York Times, and they just like have these really beautiful conversations, and I find them very like, I learn a lot, but I also empathize a lot and like figure out how to like support friends of mine better. But this particular episode was all about self-care and the language around self-care is this thing that's like, I'm going to go home and eat pasta and watch some TV, hashtag self-care. And they talked about that as like a real co-option of what self-care was, which originated as this way of treating women and people who were not cisgender and especially Black Americans in ways that the standard medical industry wasn't doing, this way of kind of like community care and healthcare. And then they go into this really great conversation about therapy, and then at the end it's just kind of like they record Wesley, because Jenna loves like potions and like witchy stuff, and they talk about the eclipse, and then it's just like they record Wesley like sniffing like just like pepper essence and this other kind of like essential oil, and it's just this like beautiful thing to be able to listen to.
You're also on a podcast if you want to.
I don't do my podcast anymore.
Time. Well, it's still out there though.
Yeah, it's called Can You Not?
There you go.
Yeah.
Sorry, we're going to wrap this
That's
up.
Okay, sorry. Binge yes. mode, great Game of Thrones podcast.
Look, I really love narrative podcasts, but only for driving, and I don't drive as much anymore because like my podcast listening has to be really, really quick, like either I'm exercising or making a meal. So I really just like good chats, like old school radio chats, and some good podcasts, like podcast landing offerings that I've really loved have been Nancy. Like if you're queer or if you've got queer people in your life you want to understand better, it's a really good app. It's made in Adelaide, I'll show you later. It's called Pocket Casts. Nancy is really, really great. I really love the Australian podcast It's Not a Race, because I think we're really bad in this country at talking about race, and the way that Beverly Wang, who is a Melbourneite, talks and gets discussions about race going, I think is really, really entertaining and important. So those would be my two.
One I was asked for, that I could give you 20, but we can talk after, but is You Must Remember This, which if you like movies at all, and old Hollywood, and it's meticulously researched, and it's these great stories of Golden Age of Hollywood, but they have these series. They had this great one on the Manson murders, and then they had this great one on dead blondes. It was different blonde movie stars who died, and now they have one on Jane Fonda and Jean Seberg, and it's wonderful. It's beautifully done. So
I'm going to say my dad wrote a porno.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Are you guys signing books downstairs? I know you are. Are you
going to ask us?
No, we're going to take you down. They'll be down at the kitchen. We're going to bookshop in the atrium. If you could thank Ben, Brittany, and me again.